أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما وفقها في الدين يا رب العالمين. اللهم افتح علينا بحكمتك، وانشر علينا برحمتك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. Inshallah, continue the study of the stories of Quran, reflections on these beautiful verses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent to mankind as guidance. And we spoke about the story of the Quran. They are the best stories. And these stories are not fictional. The word story by itself means an event that actually happened. And that is, whether it's in English or in Arabic, al-qasas. Al-Qasas is a recitation of the actual recitation of an event. Events that actually happened. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Yusuf, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ. We relate to you, unto you, the most beautiful of stories. And these stories of the Quran have certain characteristics that we went through it in the last session. And these characteristics, and you will see that theme in our continuous study, inshallah, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained for this effort to continue, that the concentration, what is the focus in the stories of Quran, is on the ibrah, is on the lesson that you can derive out of these stories. And it's not as much on the details. And any detail that is mentioned in the Qur'an, in Qasas al-Qur'an, is a detail that is important for us to extract the lesson out of it. But if it is a detail that is not important, then you will not see it in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you will see a lot of times names that are missing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, وَجَاءَ رَجُلٌ مِنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ. A man came from afar. And a man, the name of the man is not recited, is not mentioned. Like you see in other Gospels and books, for example, the Torah or the Bible that is in the hands of the people of the book right now, you'll see a lot of the historical details. Yunukh, son of Shaith, etc. And you will see a lot of these names in there. And you will see that missing a lot of times in the stories of Quran. You will see some of the historical details are not there. But everything is there is of benefit. Everything is there. And the Qur'an and the stories of Qur'an is something you will derive a lesson from. And things that are not in there, they're not important for the story itself. They will not add to the story itself. And that's why Al-Qur'an muhkam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كِتَابٌ أُحْكِمَتْ آيَاتُهُ. This Qur'an is precisely fit. It is a concise book. It is a book where every word is where it belongs. And you cannot switch it, you cannot replace it. These are the words of the majesty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the glory of His speech subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you will see that His history itself cannot contradict the stories of the Qur'an. And we will go over that inshallah on time. But for example, a lot of historical discoveries are coming our ways to show us that the Qur'an is so accurate, even historically. And when we go for example, to the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, and we see that the entire story, when he was in Egypt, he was in Misr, and yet when he's speaking of the governor of Egypt, he will say al-Malik, the king. He will not say Fir'aun. We know all the rulers of Egypt were pharaohs. But here in Surah Yusuf, you will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say al-Malik, the king. And then history tells us that the time where the Hebrews came to Egypt, it was the time of the Hyksos. And the Hyksos were kings, they were not pharaohs. So the Qur'an, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not study history. And that's just the proof that the Qur'an is so historically accurate, and it is the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without a doubt. And we started from the beginning. We started from the creation. And we said, in the beginning there was Allah. La ilaha illallah. Kan Allah. وَلَا شَيْءَ مَعَهُ. There was Allah and there was nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah does not need anything with Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is al-awwal and He is al-akhir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the first with no beginning. And He is the last with no end. هُوَ الْأَوَّلُ بِالْأَبْتِدَاءِ وَهُوَ الْآخِرُ بِالْأَنْتِهَاءِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the universe as we know it. And He started with the two creations of Al-Arsh, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Al-Qalam, the pen. And we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated in the Qur'an the glory of these creations. And He refers to Himself subhanahu wa ta'ala as Rabbul Arshil Azeem and Rabbul Arshil Kareem, the Lord of the throne, of the majestic throne, the Lord of the noble throne subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the pen and led the pen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered that pen to write everything that is and everything that will be until the end of time. Because that was all in the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even before creation itself, even before creating heavens and earth. And that is the glory, that is the capacity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created heavens and earth. The actual physical universe as we know and as we continue to discover. The planets, the stars, the galaxies, and its vastness and its glory. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this entire universe and what's beyond it. Now all we can see is as-sama, what is known as as-sama al-ula, the first heaven. This is what we can see. And the Hubble telescope and all of these inventions, all they can go out far into the galaxies, seeing the closest space to us, and that is as-sama al-ula, as-sama al-dunya, the lower heaven. The lower sky. How do we know that? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِيحِ. When you see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we have decorated the lower heaven, the first heaven above you, with masabih, with these, the objects which are the galaxies and the stars that are glow in your night sky. Those lanterns that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in heavens for us. And that is the lower sky, and we see the vastness of it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had said His entire creation of all seven heavens and all seven earth, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only knows what they are and what they mean. Because we cannot even comprehend this lower heaven that we live in. It's still a great astronomical, physical mystery. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not overburden us with things that we can, that is impossible for us to understand. But He said that entire creation of seven heavens and seven earth took Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 6 days. And during these 6 days, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this entire creation that we see around us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala detailed that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْ إِنَّكُمْ لَتَكْفُرُونَ بِالَّذِي خَلَقَ الْأَرْضَ فِي يَوْمَيْنِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created earth in 2 days. Now this physical planet, beautiful planet that we live in, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in 2 days. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and these verses from Surah Fussilat, and they're really much worthy of going back and reflecting on the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the glory, the strength, the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His creation. He said He created earth in 2 days. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَجَعَلَ فِيهَا رَوَاسِيَ مِنْ فَوْقِهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed anchors on it. And these anchors are the mountains. And that is a 20th century discovery. That these mountains are actually the cause for the stability of the crust. Of the surface of the earth that we live on. It's because of these mountains that we don't have as many earthquakes and the plates are not moving as violently as they would otherwise. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated that in His glorious book 1400 years ago. He said, these mountains are rawasi, they are anchors that stabilize it. Not only that, He blessed over the earth. And Allah knows we are living in the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it's not for the blessing of the Lord and all that corruption and all the pollution and everything we are doing to this planet should have been destroyed long time ago, one way or the other, with either a crazy atomic explosion or something that is due to the corruption of human beings. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed on the earth. And not only that, He said, وَقَدَّرَ فِيهَا أَقْوَاتَهَا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala measured therein its sustenance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the water resources that are needed for life on earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala estimated precisely everything that comes to this earth and everything that reflects away from this earth. يَعْلَمُ مَا يَلِجُ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ وَمَا يَخْرُجُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows anything that goes into it and everything that comes out of it. وَمَا يَدْخُلُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَمَا يَعْرُجُ فِيهَا. And everything that enters into heaven and everything that ascends into heaven. And you can expand that anywhere you want. The cosmic rays that come into the earth. The thickness of the atmosphere, if it was thinner, we would have burned with ultraviolet rays. We would not be able to function with the cosmic rays that would hit this earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala estimated precisely the distance between earth and sun. And if the sun was a little bit closer to us, we would burn. And if the sun was a little bit further away, we would freeze. And this is all taqdeer. And the ulama said that if you want the proof for the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can find it in the first two verses of Surah Al-A'la. سَبِّحِ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى الَّذِي خَلَقَ فَسَوَّى وَالَّذِي قَدَّرَ فَهَدَى. Praise the name of thy Lord, the Most High, الَّذِي خَلَقَ, who he created, فَسَوَّى, and he put it in its shape, in its beautiful, in its precise shape, وَالَّذِي قَدَّرَ, and then he measured. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقْنَاهُ بِقَدَرٍ وَمَا أَمْرُنَا إِلَّا وَاحِدَةٌ كَلَمْحٍ بِالْبَصَرِ. Everything we have created precisely in a very accurate measurement. These are the words of your Lord, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here it is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, all of that took him no time whatsoever. وَقَدَّرَ فِيهَا أَقْوَاتَهَا فِي أَرْبَعَةِ أَيَّامٍ. All these natural resources, the oil, the wind, the sea, the water, what lives in it, the fish, the ocean, all this wealth, all of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala estimated it from the time of creation till the time when everything is done. All of that at that very same time in the beginning of creation. فِي أَرْبَعَةِ أَيَّامٍ سَوَاءً لِلسَّائِلِينَ ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comprehended His creation in heavens, to the sky. He comprehended in His design the sky, and it had been as smoke. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this heaven, that everything was just like smoke. And here comes not only the 20th, but the 21st century to prove that these words are precise. That what we call now a cosmic dust is where all the planets and the stars came from. And we could see that now after the launch of the Hubble telescope. And you could see these beautiful pictures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creation in progress. You can see these cosmic dust, these clouds of smoke turning into stars and turning into planets. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, that's how I started you. That's how I started the creation. And that has been recorded in the Quran 1400 years ago. That this lower heaven was just smoke, was cosmic dust. And the science today tells us that that's how this started. And you can see all these beautiful images that we can see today. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called upon earth and heaven and said, "Itiya tawan aw karha." Come to the obedience of your Lord willingly or unwillingly. And they chose to come willingly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the beginning of creation. And that's another miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, another scientific miracle that is embedded in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَلَمْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ كَانَتَا رَتْقًا فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا. That heavens and earth were joined together. They were just like one big mass. They were combined. Everything you can see on heavens and earth, they were all joined together. Ratq. A ratq is something that is small that you condense things into. That's exactly what it means. And then he said, فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا. And he used the word fataq. And fataq is just a sudden spread of everything that is in there. That's in that condensed matter. And that's what we know today as the Big Bang theory of the start of the universe, the start of the cosmos that we live in. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala adds another scientific miracle, another sign in this particular verse of Surah Al-Anbiya, verse number 30. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. And off water, we made everything that is alive. And now when we look for life anywhere in the universe, we look for water. We don't look for animals that are roaming any planets. We go look for water because we know there cannot be any life if there is no water. And all of these scientific miracles are in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also told us in Surah Al-Dhariyat, verse number 47, وَالسَّمَاءَ بَنَيْنَاهَا بِأَيْدٍ وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ. And we, with power, did we construct the heavens. With hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, verily, we are able to extend the vastness of space thereof. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is extending the vastness of that space. And now again, with the scientific proof, we know that we live in an expanding universe. That the universe, it's ever expanding since the time of its creation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that in Surah Al-Dhariyat that was revealed to Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, in Arabia 1400 years ago. And that is just another sign to tell you that these are the words of truth. Have no doubt in your heart, have no doubt in your mind. You are listening to the Creator when you read those verses. You are listening to the one who knows. أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقْ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. Does he not know the one who creates? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us. He knows because he made it. And these are all signs of his creation, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he said that that creation is much bigger than the creation of human beings. And then you still have some people that argue whether Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hasha lillah, ever existed or not. And they argue if he has powers or not. And they think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a bystander. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not involved in his creation. And after we see all of these miracles and all of the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how can there be any doubt? Any doubt that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's power is beyond anything we can imagine. And the beautiful planet that we live in is the make of this wonderful, this glorious creator who created everything with measure and he created everything precisely. فَسُبْحَانَ walhamdulillah. ولا إله إلا الله. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after creating everything, he turned on to create the angels. Who are the angels? The angels are the creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and in the authentic hadith as narrated in Muslim, according to the authority of Aisha radiallahu anha, she said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خُلِقَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ مِن نُورِ. Angels were created out of light. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only knows the nature of that light. But the angels were created out of that light. They are makhluqatun nuraniya. They are creatures of light. And that light, again, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's affair. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what it is. We cannot expect that it is just photons like we know in our normal physics. It's not the light, the rays that we usually see. And Allah knows best, Allahu A'lam, what it is. But according to the hadith that we believe in, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, these angels were created out of light. وَخُلِقَ الْجَنُّ مِنْ مَارِجٍ مِنْ نَارٍ. And the jinn, we will talk about that in a little bit, were created out of flames of fire. وَخُلِقَ آدَمُ مِمَّا وُصِفَ لَكُمْ. And Adam was created from what has been described for you, the things that you know of. And we will speak about that inshallah. But these angels that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's part of iman, it is part of faith to believe in the angels, that the angels exist. We have to believe in that to fulfill our faith as Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed that faith for us, and he mentioned it in the Quran many times. And in the famous hadith of Jibreel alayhi salam, when he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked him about the iman, and he said, you have to believe in Allah and his angels. And تُؤْمِنَ بِاللَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَكُتُبِهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَالْقَدَرِ خَيْرِهِ وَشَرِّهِ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. You have to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to believe in his angels. So we, etc. to the end of the hadith. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the angels into messengers with wings. So they fly. We don't know the exact creation of the angels. We just take it as is. And we don't argue the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that they have wings that are two pairs or three or four. And then maybe more. يَزِيدُ فِي الْخَلْقِ مَا يَشَاءُ. And he increases in creation what he wills. And we know some of the description that has been narrated in the books of Siyar, that Jibreel alayhi salam has 600 wings. How can you fit? You know, this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's miracle. This is Allah's creation. And we take it as is. These are things that are beyond us and beyond our imagination. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw Jibreel in its form, and he saw it two times, one in the beginning of Risala, and one at the time of Mi'raj, ascension to heaven. He saw Jibreel on it's his real creation, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in awe. It was a sight that is not for any human being to handle. And that is the glory of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه والمؤمنون كل آمن بالله وملائكته. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the messenger believes in what has been sent down for him from his Lord, and so do the believers. Each one believes in Allah, his angels, his book, and his messengers. So we have to believe in these messengers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that the malaika are the custodians of hellfire. And the malaika are the custodians of heavens, of al-jannah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our destination to al-jannah and not to the hellfire, inshaAllah. And those angels have jobs. These angels, each one of them have a specific job that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created that angel for. And we know when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was coming out of Ta'if, the angel of mountains came to him. An angel that has been given the job of preserving the mountains or moving the mountains by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know there is the angel of death. The angels that are precisely giving the mission to take the souls away from our bodies when it is the prescribed time from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these angels have functions, and these functions are ordained by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they are creatures that obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala constantly. They're not like us, and they're not like al-jinn. There are sinners among the human beings, and there are disobedient among the jinn. But among the malaika, there is none. The malaika are obedient creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Anbiya 19 and 20, وَلَهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَنْ عِنْدَهُ لَا يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِهِ وَلَا يَسْتَحْسِرُونَ يُسَبِّحُونَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارِ لَا يَفْتُرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, to him belongs whosoever is in the heavens and on earth. And those who are near him, that means the angels, are not too proud to worship him. They have no arrogance whatsoever. Although they're some of the mightiest creatures that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ever created, yet they have no boastfulness, no arrogance, and no pride in worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nor they are weary of his worship. They, the angels, glorify his praises night and day, and they never slacken or fatigue. So they are special creatures that never get tired of praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's presence. And then after creating al-malaika, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now is glorified and praised, and he is worshipped in his glory and his creation. So why create more? That is the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is beyond us. That is when we say, when we think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no matter how far we go, we can only think using our human mind. We have no other tool to think about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah is beyond that. Allah's glory is beyond that. Allah's wisdom is beyond that, and Allah's knowledge is beyond that. But those who think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates only human beings or jinn so they can just perform the act of worship and the ritual of worship, that is really answered by many scholars that say Allah had the angels long before. And they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala diligently. And they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continuously. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not done yet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created al-jinn. Created those creatures who are called al-jinn. Al-jinn are created out of fire. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala authenticated that in Surah Ar-Rahman and many other places. وَخَلَقَ الْجَنَّ مِنْ مَارِجٍ مِنْ نَارٍ. And the jinn, he created from smokeless flame of fire. It's just from the tips of that flame that burning, clean burning flame, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the jinn out of. And that is again authenticated in that hadith we recited in Sahih Muslim on the authority of Aisha radiallahu anha, خُلِقَ الْجَانُ مِنْ مَارِجٍ مِنْ نَارٍ. And in other, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that He created jinn before He created human beings. So we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created those creatures that we cannot see, but they can see us. Now that is another characteristic of al-jinn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that in the Quran about Iblis. إِنَّهُ يَرَاكُمْ وَقَبِيلُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا تَرَوْنَهُمْ. They see you from where you cannot see them. So we are visually blocked from seeing the jinn, but they are not. They can see us. And of them there are righteous jinn, and of them there are disobedient jinn. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that He created jinn first. And that is in the Quran, in Surah Al-Hijr. وَالْجَانَّ خَلَقْنَاهُ مِنْ قَبْلُ مِنْ نَارِ السَّمُومِ. And the jinn race, we had created before Adam. Because the verse that is just before that one, verse 26, says, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ صَلْصَالٍ مِنْ حَمَئٍ مَسْنُونٍ. We created man from sounding clay, from mud molded into shape, and then the jinn we created. Then we had the jinn created before from the fire of scorching wind. The jinn are Muslims, some of them, and they listened to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they took message from him. And that is authenticated in Surah Al-Jinn. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recites there, وَأَنَّا مِنَّا الْمُسْلِمُونَ وَمِنَّا الْقَاسِتُونَ فَمَنْ أَسْلَمَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ تَحَرَّوْا رَشَدًا. Amongst us, the jinn are some that submit to Allah and some that swerve from justice, swerve from the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now those who submit their wills to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they have sought out the path of right conduct. And Iblis, لَعَنَهُ اللَّهُ, Iblis, the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descended on him, he is of al-jinn. Because you might go into some references and you will see some other theories out there. But the jumhur, the majority of ulama, they said, according to the Quran, that al-jinn always have included Iblis among them. And Iblis was always of al-jinn. Because some of the books out there will say, well, Iblis was of al-malaika, was an angel, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned him into jinn. But most ulama said he always been a jinn. Always Iblis was of al-jinn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Kahf, إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ كَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِّ فَفَسَقَ عَنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Iblis, he was one of the jinn. And then he broke the command of his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those jinn are always with us. And they, many of them, are the soldiers of Iblis, Junudu Iblis. And they whisper to us. They try to seduce us. They try to tempt us into disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like Iblis seduced our parents into disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will go over that, inshallah, in more detail. But that is in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about al-jinn. He said, مَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا وَقَدْ وُكِّلَ بِهِ قَرِينُهُ مِنَ الْجِنِّ. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there is not one of you, human beings, إِلَّا وَقَدْ وُكِّلَ بِهِ. They have been given a custody, a mission to a qareen, to a partner, to somebody who is always a companion of al-jinn, that is always with you, always with us. And they said, وَإِيَّاكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, even you, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. And he said, وَإِيَّايَ, even myself. إِلَّا أَنَّ اللَّهَ أَعَانَنِي عَلَيْهِ فَأَسْلَمْ. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped me, so he became a Muslim. So the qareen of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is one of the good jinn. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide all of our qareens here. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about this, tells us that these jinn will get and start whispering these ideas into our hearts. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the very concluding chapter of Al-Quran, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ إِلَهِ النَّاسِ مِنْ شَرِّ الْوَسْوَاسِ الْخَنَّاسِ الَّذِي يُوَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ. We take refuge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the Lord of people, from the waswas al-khannas, the whispering that sneak into the hearts of human beings and whisper the bad evil acts and the bad evil thoughts into our hearts. And our job is to reject that and to take refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that is the work of jinn. That is the work of jinn for a wisdom that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows, to test a human being, to show ourselves and to show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who we really are and what we are really made of. But we have to believe in al-jinn, a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that preceded the creation of Adam alayhi salam. And then we come to the first chapter of our study, inshallah. And the first chapter starts with the first human being and the first prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Adam alayhi salam. And the story starts with an announcement that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made. And this announcement Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made fi a'la aliyin, in the highest of high, among his angels. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala announced, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firmly announced, he said, behold, your Lord said to the angels, I will create a vicegerent on earth. And if we just stop with these few words, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. I am creating on earth a vicegerent. First thing that, now this, what we are doing here is reflection on the verses of Quran. We are studying Quran, not just the stories of Quran. But we have to reflect on the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by words that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ, tells us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has preordained that the progeny of Adam alayhi salam will live where? On earth. So some people, they sit down and they say, well, if it is not for the sin of Adam, we would have been where? In heaven. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, not so. From before creating Adam, I have ordained that you all will live on earth. إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. He didn't say, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي السَّمَاءِ, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. He said, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. So to defend the prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Adam, it was preordained. Adam and Hawa, our mother and our father, did not take us out of heaven. We were not planned to be in heaven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ordainment. We were planned to be on this earth. And that is even, that happened even from Musa alayhi salam. And this hadith in Al-Bukhari, and it is narrated in many books, this hadith said that when Adam saw Musa alayhi salam, Musa complained to Adam and he said, if it is not for your sin, we would have been on heaven. We would have been in heaven. We would not have all this misery on earth. And Adam answered him back and he said, well, that is a preordainment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before he created me, that you're going to be on earth. It's not my fault that you are on earth. It's not my fault that you are going through the human testing. Allah has preordained that. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Fahajja Musa Adam." Then Hajja Adam Musa. Then Adam actually won that conversation with Musa alayhi salam, because he's right. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa." So don't blame anybody but ourselves for anything that happens to humanity. It is not the fault of Hawa, like many of the people of the book say. Hawa is the reason, Eve is the reason why we're out of heaven. And it is not the fault of Adam. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that already, before he created any of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have ordained, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. That we are going to be on earth, and we are on earth. Then the second word that we need to understand in this verse is the word khalifa. What is a khalifa? And who is a khalifa? And why are we khalifa? And what is our job as a khalifa? Are we fulfilling our mission as a khalifa? Now the khalifa can mean different things. One meaning, and you will see also that in the books. The first meaning is a simple meaning of the word khalifa. And that means a progeny that succeed one another, meaning one family, children, the parents die, the children have children, and it goes on, and it's istikhlaf, it's a succession. It is more, it's a progeny, it's a dynasty, it is one layer of the family tree taking over another layer. And that's what human beings are. We, from the time of Adam alayhi salam onward, we are mustakhlafin. We are succeeding. We succeed our parents and grandparents and great-grandparents, and they in turn succeeded their parents and so forth. But that is the simple meaning. A more deeper meaning of Khalifa is a vicegerent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created a human being for a purpose, for a reason. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said and challenges us. He said, أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ. Do you think we have just created you in vain? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if I wanted to play, because some people may even think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just wanted entertainment and He created humanity. He said, لَوْ أَرَدْنَا لَهْوًا لَاتَّخَذْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا. If I wanted entertainment, I would have gotten entertainment. This is in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you have been created for a very high purpose. And this word Khalifa is the key to why we are created on earth and why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put us here. The Khalifa, what is the word? What is the function of a vicegerent? If you just take the human example of a vicegerent, of a khalifa. If you were a king of some kingdom, and you send a vicegerent to one of the estates, what do you want for that vicegerent to do? It's to perform your orders. It's to fulfill the commands that you send that vicegerent to do. And that is the khalifa. We as human beings, as they're given the mission of Khilafatullah ala al-ard, to be vicegerents of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this earth, we have the mission of going by the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to fulfill those laws and to live by them. And a vicegerent, the Khalifa, we have to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the complete meaning of the word. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us over and over in the Quran, I don't need your worship. I don't need your salah. I don't need your zakah. I don't need your siyam. I don't need any of that. إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ حَمِيدٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is self-sustained. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't need us to do that. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be glorified, He has been glorified from the beginning of His creation by His angels. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you have that mission to worship me in the larger meaning, in the larger understanding of this world, the word, by taking the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fulfill that on earth and to live by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed us without seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To believe in heaven without seeing heaven. To believe in the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the hellfire without seeing hellfire. To go by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed. And that is to be a vicegerent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then we have to build the earth. We have to take this planet into a much higher and a much better shape. And provide good life for everyone. And that is why always the Islam, the religion of Islam, in its own perfection, tells us to take care of each other. And to take care of people we don't know. And to always do something that is good. And then in a famous hadith that's known as Hadith al-Fasila, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us about our mission here on earth. And he said, if you have a small plant in your hand, and the day of judgment has come, then plant it. You know everything is going to disappear. Everything is going to ruin. There will be no more people on the face of the earth. But just do something. Do something that is constructive. And that is the mission of a human being on the face of the earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Allah put you on earth, وَاسْتَعْمَرَكُمْ فِيهَا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala order you to build on it, to build everything that is good, and to fight corruption. And that's when we speak about the best nation ever came out to mankind, the nation of Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. You have been the best nation that humanity has ever seen, with conditions. تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. You have to enjoin the good and prohibit the evil. And if we don't fulfill that, we're not fulfilling the khilafah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this earth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala announced to the angels, He said, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. The angels asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a very curious question that came from the angels. And they said, قَالُوا أَتَجْعَلُوا فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءِ وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. The angels said, will you place therein one who will make mischief and shed blood while we do celebrate your praise and glorify you? Now what kind of question is that? Why the angels are even asking that question? Didn't we just say the angels have no choice but to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And they exactly do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed them for them to do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ. They do exactly as they told. So how come they're asking a question here? What kind of a question is that? Now in the Arabic language, and in many languages actually, and you can see that even in the English, there are different types of questions. There are questions that you ask to really inquire about something. To ask about something you really don't know. A question coming of ignorance. I don't know why this is, so please tell me. And that is called in Arabic as su'al al-istifhami. Inquisitive question. You're inquiring about something. And of an example of that in the Quran, when Musa alayhi salam was riding with the knowledgeable person on the ship, and the knowledgeable man that was with Musa made a hole in the ship. And then Musa asked him, أَخَرَقْتَهَا لِتُغْرِقَ أَهْلَ. Actually, that's not really the right example. Let me give you another example. When Ibrahim alayhi salam broke the idols for the people that he was living amongst, he drew in their idols. So the people came out and they asked him, what did they say? أَنْتَ فَعَلْتَ هَذَا بِآلِهَتِنَا يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ. Are you the one who did this? And they're asking, really, are you the one who did this? This is an inquisitive question. They're inquiring. Did you do it or did you not do it? And it's like you're asking a question and you need to know the answer. But the second type of question is what I was actually going with my example with. The second type of question is known as سؤال استنكاري. It is a question that you're objecting to something about. And that's when Musa alayhi salam was riding with that knowledgeable person on the ship. And Musa made a hole in it. And then the knowledgeable man made a hole in it. And Musa asked him, he said, أَخَرَقْتَهَا لِتُغْرِقَ آلَهَا. Did you make that hole so you can sink the ship and sink the people on it? He's objecting. He's objecting to that act. And then the third one is a question of knowledge, meaning you know something but you want to emphasize it to others, so you ask a question. And it's known as su'al al-arif. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks a lot of these questions in the Quran. أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ. Aren't I your Lord? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ. Allah knows the answer, of course. It's not an inquisitive question. It's not objection. But Allah, this is for emphasis. This is to emphasize the knowledge in the one that is being asked the question. So what kind of a question the angels asked? What kind of a question these angels were asking? Now they don't know. So it cannot be سؤال العارف. It cannot be a question of someone who knows. And they cannot object to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will, because they are not that kind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that these angels, they only do what they are told. So the jumhur, the ulama, said that this was really an inquisitive question, which is allowable. They just needed to know. They were asking Why are you going to put someone on there who will place mischief and shed blood? So there comes the question again, how did they know that? How did they know that the human race will actually do that? Will spread corruption and they will shed blood? How did they know that? The Mufassirin said that, and there are three opinions on that. The first opinion, how did the angels know that there will be corruption from the progeny of Adam, which we see all around us, and bloodshed, which is overwhelming on earth? How do they know that? There are three opinions. Ibn Umar and Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhuma, they said, the jinn inhabited earth before Adam, alayhi salam. The first intelligent inhabitants of earth were al-jinn, were the jinn. And they spread corruption and they shed blood. And according to the opinion of Ibn Umar and Ibn Abbas, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent armies of angels to fight them off and to end their corruption. And those armies were led by Iblis, who was a righteous of the jinn at that time. And he was hiding his disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He himself was not even aware of it at that time. And according to the narration of Ibn Umar and Ibn Abbas, the jinn were defeated after they spread corruption on earth, and they were kicked out and expelled by the army of angels, and for the role that Iblis played in that struggle, he was taken to heaven, and he was put in the ranks of angels. And that's when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would speak to angels, he was included because he was among their ranks. But he was a jinn. That is one opinion to Ibn Umar, Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abi Hatim, he said that the angels knew that the creation of earth itself can be corrupted. That anything that is created out of earth can be corrupted. And he also had another opinion that there may be people before humans that inhabited the earth, that are not jinn, but other races, other sort of a humanoid. And now we see all of these, discoveries about these tribes and the people that are lived before human beings, before the Homo sapiens, and they call them the Neanderthals and many other names. And there is now scientific evidence that these creatures lived in packs and they fought each other and they killed each other. So one opinion, according to Ibn Abi Hatim, that the angels witnessed that and they saw that when that happens, then there would be corruption and bloodshed, and they were asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why are you going to put Adam and his progeny on earth when you know there will be corruption and bloodshed, like it happened before? Al-Hasan al-Basri, that is the third opinion, according to Al-Hasan al-Basri from the At-Tabi'een, he said Allah inspired them. Allah already told them that I will put a vicegerent on earth and there will be corruption and bloodshed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already told them that this will happen, but I'm going to do it anyway. And when they asked that question, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, my knowledge is bigger than yours, and my wisdom is bigger than yours. إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them that you will not know this now. You will not get the answer right now, and you will get it later, like we will get it later. So that is the first question that they asked. أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَا يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءُ. But the second question, the second comment they made, they said, وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. Why we celebrate your praise and glorify you. What does that mean? That is one evidence that the ulama said that the reason of creation of human beings is not only to just make tasbih and make the ritual ibadah. That is one part, essential part of our existence. But that's not the only part. We have to work on spreading good. And we have to work on building the earth, and we have to work on fighting corruption. And a Muslim is a abid, amil. He is a worshipper that works. He's a worshipper that do things. Not only a worshipper that is locked in a masjid or in a sawma'a or in a, like a monk in a place of isolation. A Muslim has to be active and has to do things to improve life on earth for himself, for his family, for his community, and for the people that he lives amongst, and for the general humanity at large. And that is one of the conclusion of these verses. The second thing, the second opinion is the malaika feared truly that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is creating a khalifa, that they might have made some shortcomings. Maybe they did not do what they're supposed to do. And they were asking, وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. Are we doing all we can? Are we not doing all what we are supposed to do? And that is one explanation that you will see in the books of tafsir. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. The mufassirin commented, the people that explained the Quran commented on that. That number one, that the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is vast. And no creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, including the malaika, including those who are close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they witness His glory, and they witness His creation, and they hold the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says that this, I have knowledge that you will not have. إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. So that knowledge of Allah and that wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beyond even those angels. And you can see even human beings, they say, if something doesn't make sense to them and it doesn't fit into their norms, then they will reject it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, there will always be things that you will not understand about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even the angels could not understand this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered them by saying, I know things that you don't know. And my knowledge is much vaster than your knowledge. Other mufassirin said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His knowledge, on His knowing of the what is coming in the human race, He knows that there will be the negative, there will be the corruption, and there will be the bloodshed, and there will be the facade, but Allah knows only that there will be the prophets. There will be al-siddiqeen, the saints. There will be the martyrs. There will be al-saliheen, there will be the good. And that good overwhelms the bad. And for that good, it is worth it to create everything else. And of them, there will be Ibrahim. Of them, there will be Isa. Of them, there will be Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And for these servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what good is going to come out of the believers, then that overwhelms the corruption and overwhelms anything that can come out of the bloodshed that is on the face of the earth. Wallah subhanahu wa ta'ala a'lam. The other thing is to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names. If there will be no corruption on earth, there will be no sinners, then there will be no forgiveness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-ghaffar. Allah is the all-forgiving. And if there is no sins and there are no believers that are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, then that name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that attributes will not be realized in its form. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created people who will sin and Allah forgives. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that in the hadith, if it is not that you sin and you ask Allah for forgiveness, Allah will bring people that will sin and ask Him for forgiveness. If it is not, if it's something that you don't do, Allah will do it. If we don't need Allah, then how is He al-Razzaq? How is He the provider? If we don't ask for mercy, then how is He al-Rahman? All of these attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if there is no tyrants on earth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would ruin, then how is He al-Qahhar? How is He al-Jabbar? Then all that corruption, there is wisdom in it. And all that bloodshed, and all the sins, and all of that, there is a wisdom that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. And if you don't put something against its opposite, its contrast, you will not really see it. If you don't put the believer against the non-believer, you don't see the mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed on the believer. And the lack of for the non-believer that rejected that mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends His mercy on everyone. and everything. رحمتي وسعت كل شيء. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, my mercy is sent on everyone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not discriminate. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to everyone. But human beings sometimes reject what comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إني أعلم ما لا تعلمون. I know what you know not. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala finished that conversation with the angels. And then he started the creation of Adam. How was Adam created? How did we come about? How did we start to exist? According to the hadith of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari as narrated in Ahmad, Abu Tawud, and at-Tirmidhi, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَلَقَ آدَمَ مِنْ قَبْضَةٍ قَبَضَهَا مِنْ جَمِيعِ الْأَرْضِ فَجَاءَ بَنُو آدَمَ عَلَى قَدَرِ الْأَرْضِ فَجَاءَ مِنْهُمُ الْأَحْمَرُ وَالْأَبْيَضُ وَالْأَسْوَدُ وَبَيْنَ ذَلِكَ وَالسَّهْلُ وَالْحَزَنُ وَالْخَبِيثُ وَالطَّيِّبُ. Translate the hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى خَلَقَ آدَمَ مِنْ قَبْضَةٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grabbed a fist, some of the earth itself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started the creation of Adam of the dust, of the soil of this earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this qabda, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gathered to create Adam, it had everything. All the elements, all the different types of the what you see on earth. So you see there's some hard soil, there's some rocks, there's some soft sand, all of that mixed together into that character. And the earth has different colors. You have some black stone, you have some white stone, you have some red stone, you have some yellow stones. All of these colors are the colors of human beings. And the Prophet ﷺ said, of them came the red, of them came the white, of them came the black, and anything that is a mixed of any of that. And then the nature of human beings also comes from the earth. منهم السهل, the easy one, the flat, easy earth that you just smooth park, valley, you know, hill, things that are easy to dwell in. والحزن, things that are difficult, rocky, some characters you feel they're hard. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you know, that created us all out of this earth. And the characters of this earth will form into our personality, according to this hadith. والحزن, some of them are difficult to deal with. والخبيث, some of them are just not good. Some type of earth is just not good. You have the swamps, you have the rotten places, the barren, the wild desert. So some of them are just khabith. وَالطَّيِّبَ, and some of them are good. And that is where we started our creation, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started our creation. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala authenticate that in Surah Ar-Rum, Allah, and many other places. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَكُمْ مِنْ تُرَابٍ. Of his signs that he created you from dust, from the soil of the earth. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mixed another element with the turab, and that is the water. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. Of water, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made every living thing. So the two main elements that we are created of are dust and water. Soil and water. Now reflect on these two elements. If you want to purify yourself and make wudu, what do you use for your ablution? Water. Pure. It's a symbol of something that is pure, that washes things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us out of that purity. The second thing, that if you don't have water, what do you use? Dust. You use soil. The second element that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us with. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us from the two elements that we purify ourselves with. From pure elements. From things that are clean. Things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not make us out of cheap things. Out of purity. And inshallah wa ta'ala we'll continue that in the next session. We will go over the creation of Adam alayhi salam and the test that was given to Iblis and he failed in it. And then the test that was given to our father Adam alayhi salam. And inshallah we will be reflecting on that next session. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فيا فوز المستغفرين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.